Chapter 18. We got in two cars to drive for an hour and a half north of Grand Rapids. We were headed to a dinky town called Macosta. I got to ride with the band while Mr. Jimmy and Herman E. Calloway and the instruments were riding in the Packard. Miss Thomas stayed back at Grand Calloway Station. I've been living with Miss Thomas and the band for about 7 days, and this was already my third trip on the road. The band was doing their next favorite thing to playing music. They were teasing each other and talking about Herman E. Calloway behind his back. The thug said the dirty deed. I'd be offended, man. And I ain't trying to say that you ain't good on the 88s, but you know the only reason you got this gig is 'cause you're Dutch, you're white, and you don't have the strongest personality in the world. Deed said, yeah, well, such is life. You think I'm going to give up the best gig in the state just 'cause you'd be offended? Take a look out the window, baby. There's a depression going on. How many folks you see living like us, Negro or white? Not many. That man may have his faults, but he's a struggler. I'm putting my hat in with him. Eddie looked at him and said, Bud, Mr. C has always got a white fella in the band for practical reasons, but we don't hold his skin color against him. He can't help that he was born that way. Deed said, you're just too kind, Edward. Eddie kept talking. We do that 'cause the boy can play. Mr. C won't compromise on his music. I said, why does he always keep one white guy in the band? Deed said, it's the way of the world, Sleepy. It's against the law for a Negro to own any property out where the log cabin is, so Mr. C put it in my name. Eddie said, that and a lot of times we get gigs playing polkas and waltzes, and a lot of these white folks wouldn't hire us if they knew we were a Negro band, so Deed goes out and sets up everything. But what do they say when the Dusky Devastators show up? Deed said, well, it's too late for them to say anything then. It's us or no music. Eddie said, and Mr. C tells them if we aren't the best band they'd ever had, then they don't have to pay. We haven't been stiffed yet. With all the arguing and jokes about Mr. C, the trip seemed real short. We unloaded all of the instruments and waited for nighttime to come. I'd heard the band play and practice 1,000 times, and still had to just about sit on my hands when they were finished so I wouldn't bust out clapping. We finished our set at a little place called the Laughing Jackass, and I got to sleep right on stage to guard the instruments. The next morning I was packing everything into the cases when I got some real bad news. Herman E. Calloway told Mr. Jimmy, I must stay and catch up with Eugene. You head back with the boys. The man who owned the club, Mr. Eugene Miller, used to be in one of Mr. C's bands. Mr. Jimmy said, Bud, take your time loading everything into the Packard, and you can ride back with Herman. Uh-oh. Me and Mr. C looked at each other like this wasn't a good idea. He said, whatever, and walked back to the club's office. Shucks, a whole hour and a half trapped in a car with him. I loaded all of the instruments into the Packard, sat on a big rock, and took out my recorder to practice. I could hear Mr. C and Mr. Miller talking and laughing for the longest time. At last, Herman E. Calloway came out and walked over to the side of the building and started nudging things around with the toe of his shoe. I walked over to watch what he was doing. When I got next to him, I could see that it was just rocks he was pushing around. Finally, he grunted a couple of times and started to bend over, but his big belly got in the way and wouldn't let his arms reach to the ground. After a bunch more grunts, he said, make yourself useful, boy, and hand me this one. This what, sir? This stone, this one. Right at the end of Mr. C's shiny brown shoe was a little roundish rock. I bent over to pick it up, blew some dirt off of it, and turned it over a couple of times in my hand to try and see why Mr. C thought it was so special. The only thing that I could tell was that he'd picked a perfect throwing rock, the exact same kind of rock I'd use if I was about to chunk someone in the head. I dropped it into his hand. He didn't look at it or nothing, just stuck it in his pocket, and I heard it bang up against some silver dollars. I kept my nose out of his business for as long as I could, then had to say, Mr. C, wasn't that just a rock? Sure was. He started walking back to the Packard. I followed. There were a million ways to ask what I wanted to know, and I chose the worst one when I said, "What in Sam Hill are you going to do with a doggone rock?" It sounded a lot meaner than I wanted it to, but I was really surprised that Mr. C would want an old rock. He climbed in on one side of the Packard, and I climbed in on the other. After he stuck the key in the dashboard, he said, "Bad habit." Then he leaned over toward me and opened the glove box of the car. There weren't any gloves or maps or papers in the box, just a bunch of perfect throwing rocks. They all looked like they had writing on them. I reached in and took one of the rocks out. Written on the back of it was Idlewild M.5.2.36. I took another one, and it said Preston N.6.4.36. These were just like my rocks. I took one more, and it said Chicago IL.3.19.32. I looked over to Mr. C and said, "I've got some of these, sir." He said, "Really, I've got some too." He looked at me, shifted his pipe away from the talking side of his mouth, and said, "Bud, I know you're not the sharpest knife in the drawer, and I hate to be the bearer of bad tidings, but those are found all over the world. In fact, they're about as common as rocks." I almost didn't answer him, but since I didn't want to look so stupid, I said, "Yes, sir, but mine have writing and numbers on them, too." He said,